certainly as part of cell care prevention work that Judy's leading upon, but certainly community connectors, which alongside Council of Whittingham, I have a particular soft spot for because I've seen them in action, that is absolutely fundamental to the work of our neighbourhoods. You mentioned how it tackles loneliness, how communities together identifies unmet need, but also looks at meeting that need in different ways that are not necessarily statutory interventions, which many people actually don't want. So these need to feature absolutely in many aspects of our plans going forward, and Julie's role as within Healthy Rural will make sure that happens. Just a quick question though, just in terms of your finance and the risk issues, there's clearly a key risk in terms of public health grant, you know, local authorities have not had such a beneficent settlement perhaps as the NHS element of our work. So it might be, we probably need to understand that risk fairly early on, and then understand whether that would require, again, the strength of the pool of resources to keep some of these essential preventative services working, and actually some of these aren't preventative, they're actually treatment.
It's just a comment, really, Julie. Having been concerned with a lot of other people as to what actually happens to the public health budget once it left the NHS and went into local authority, and I think we're about 5 years on now, I think it's really heartening to see that that budget is spent on such programmes that were in place before public health rejoined the local authority, and that how well it works in partnership with the work of the CCG and wider strategic stands of work.
Thanks, Sylvia and Simon. I suppose just with regard to the risk, and anything that the CCG could do really to highlight the challenges we've got around the budget, I think would be really helpful. Because the fact that we're sitting here in December 2019 and we don't know what's going to happen to the budget in just over 12 months' time does create anxiety. And I think we have shown that we've been very prudent with the budget whilst we've been within the council. And Sally, you're absolutely right, a lot of this is treatment services for the NHS. So it is, I suppose, hopefully you can tell, a real frustration that we to go at risk around these contracts because there isn't that certainty post April, March 2020.
Any more comments, questions? Sorry, Alan.
Thanks, we just briefly on that same point of financial risk because Simon asked a question I was intending to ask because I noticed in the section on risk, Julie, you've talked about mitigating actions in terms of the way that you're going to manage contracts should that position arise. But I think it's always also worth us considering in health that this same problem is being faced around all of the local CCGs that I have under my job, and it may well be an issue that's worth taking up in force rather than individually as organisations.
That's a good comment. Is this worth feeding back to the health and care partnership? And take it back to that, yeah. Wow. So, if we have that action, that would be helpful. Thank you. Clearly, from the amount of discussion, we rightly see the importance of this area of work. On comment I was going to make, it was very good that you highlighted all the engagement work that's been discussed in the report, and I noticed it talks about key partners, and I think there's a whole range of key partners. However, since we've got a number of GPs sitting around here, I think GPs would be really critical to engage with around this, because they're one of the frontline staff at these. Not the only frontline staff, obviously, but one of the frontline staff that these issues present to. So that's really helpful, thank you, and I'm sure it will report back further to us. So, following on from what Paul rightly said, this is a public health commission, so I'd ask the members of the governing body to make a comment about whether we support this, and then I'll pass over to Chris as chair of the council section to make a decision. So, can I ask governing body members, are we happy to support? Thank you. Chris.
Thank you, Sue. Stuart, are you happy to recommend that the recommissioning of these contracts to receive the report? Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Okay, now we're on item 8, which is the extra care housing development. Simon, do move forward.
In terms of planning with growth in our population and growing the
Simon. Comments, questions, Stuart?
Thanks, Simon. Child at the centre of decision making, whereas I think in the past we've made decisions
there were a self call and e-hassle from the area commander from Merseyside Police, all working to look at what all your arrangements should be. What we're looking at is actually this is an opportunity, so we're not going to lift and shift what we've got, but we're going to learn from what we've got and bring what's new with us that actually change things, and we're going to embed the staff as our platform of how we want to work. So that's sort of a nutshell. So this will probably be the last safeguarding board paper that you will see. There will be something new for next year, and it's an exciting year. Thank you.
Thanks, Lord. Obviously, we're all very aware of how important it is, as you say, following the office said that we want to see improved for the children world.
Thanks, Lorna. I've just got two things to say, and one good one in my classroom. So I've done my staff training, and I have to say, it was the best bit of child protection training that I've gone through in my whole 25 years. It was really, really hands-on, kind of got to the nub of it, and I thought it was really excellent, so thank you for that. However, I am still frustrated by the lack of communication, poor communication around safeguarding, generally for individual children. So I mean, one of the things that was identified in multiple of the high-profile child protection cases was when we look at Dan Lillard, Taylor, and Victoria Timbier, and Baby P, all the things that have come out in common around that was about different agencies not communicating well between each other. And I still feel that's going on in Wirral to some extent. We're still not getting updated child safeguarding reports when children have been through safeguarding. And it's so frustrating, we feel like we have to chase around this all the time. And I'd really like to see a priority for that to be kind of fixed in the next year.
Yeah, thank you, Sean. Thank you very much for the feedback about the staff, because it does feel like there's a lot of work that's going on. That's brilliant. With regards to the communication around safeguarding and child protection, I think you're absolutely right. The communication hasn't been good, and that has been identified in all the things that did make this request. If Paul was here today, he would say he's been in post now for 12 months and one day. It's his anniversary this week. And when he came into post, one of the things he had to do was get the structures and the processes right, because he hasn't had it right then. And I think because of that, that's why the communication has not been great, because there were things where we weren't, I'm saying we because we have responsibility for our children, that we weren't compliant with a number of things. And internally, Paul has recognised that and has taken steps to do things. I think coming out of his first year, processes are now in place. He's got these key individuals in place. Some of the stories we've heard is that the children who are being looked after had a change of 23 social workers. That clearly is unacceptable. So therefore, what you're seeing is poor communication because the structures weren't right and silent. Now we've got stability within that workforce. I think what we're going to see is in the forthcoming year is improvements in our communication. It is a two-way thing as well, that we need to also be inputting from a health perspective into child protection as well. So thank you for that. I'll think that Simon.
So again, safeguarding is part of a wider agenda around children, young people, and families. But this report is testament to what's going on just in the safeguarding area. I think we just have to look at Dame Andy Atkinson's foreword in terms of provide assurance of continued determination to go on getting better at keeping children safe. But there's quite an ominous warning within that foreword in regard to the monetary limits that partners are being required to work within with the increasing demand for these services. So it's something we actually need to keep in mind. And it does, as Norma highlights, the statute requirements are changing, but we absolutely need to keep the focus on safeguarding and improving life for children and young people generally, not just those who would be subject to safeguarding support. So, again, Paul is not here, but I think his testament to the work he has led across the system in the last year
Thank you very much for all attending.